I was told about it like super last minute because I'm filling in for somebody. I'm a PhD student. I started in 2014. I'm doing brain-computer interaction, and we're trying to find ways to communicate with the computer using multiple ways. So the research I've done so far was a lot of work in how we can use brain-computer interaction. And a typical brain-computer interface would be a headband or those caps you put on your head. If you've seen like in those movies, or maybe you watch BBC, the tech show, and you've seen like things like this that you put across your forehead like that, and you put it across your forehead like that, and pretty much what it does, it takes the potential, the voltage potential on your forehead using these nano connectors. And the brilliance about these this new technology is that before you had to have that kind of cap. It looks like a shower cap or one of the maybe a diving cap, and you put it around your head, and it had all these little sensor points, 64, sometimes 62, and there's different like standards for it, but all of them had this problem that you had to pour in this gel inside to make that connection work better. And all these wires around, like imagine 64 cables just coming and attaching you to this huge computer, like processing all this information. So if you imagine in that in your head, like that's a very restrictive device. Now we have this. This just came out last year. It's a Muse headband. So what this tells us now, the technology is going towards a kind of, I guess, wireless solution. So this is wireless. It fits in. It's really light. When I put it on my forehead, feels like I'm just wearing a second pair of glasses. After a while, I forget about it. So looking at this kind of trend, you kind of think, okay, so before it used to be this kind of medical device, now it's going towards a more accessory kind of thing. You know, glasses used to be uncool, now they're pretty cool. People wear different styles. So what if BCI, brain computer interaction, became an accessory that was cool? Like you have the Microsoft band that people could wear as a fashion, or the Apple watch now that's the kind of remarketed that as a fashion accessory, not like a utility device. So going towards that, my research has been focused on how can we communicate with computers using multiple levels of interaction. So what you're used to is the computer screen and your typing using the keyboard. Maybe now some of you might have a touch screen on your computer. So you have touch, you have the keyboard, and for a lot of people, voice input is a necessity. So it's an essential way of communicating with the device. Some people who are suffering from stroke or some other learning difficulties or cerebral palsy, they communicate using their eyes. So they have an eye tracking device on they're in front of them, and then while they're sitting in their usual place, they look at the screen, and the eye tracking hardware follows their eyes, and there's something called dwell. So when they dwell on an icon, for example, that zooms out, and then they could sub-select in that region. So that's how people with who use eye gaze to communicate work. So we have that, we have the voice, we have the normal way. The kind of more popular way of communicating is just typing on a keyboard using the mouse to select items. But a more kind of overcompassing way of understanding what the user wants is called effective computing. Some of you guys might, that's like a key term, it's a hot term to say, like the user state. So what am I feeling when I'm putting like my arm like this, or if I have my hand up like that? Like, it can mean different things for different people, but understanding where the user is and predicting where they want to go is really important to understand that give the user a better and more accurate kind of experience. And I guess maybe some of you are from an HCI background, human-computer interaction background. Some of you may not be, but all of you understand how nice it is when you're using a device, it's functional, it makes you feel in control, and It does what you want it to with the pleasing satisfaction that you get from it when it works how you want it to and it gives you the feedback you want. So that's just HCI in like a few words. But there's when you're using a device and when you start using it and you feel irritated with it, you put that aside and you start using something else. You get distracted, you get uninspired, but when something works how you want it to, productivity goes up, you feel better, and you like that device better. You make a personal connection with it. So we have that, we have HCI, we have the future of effective state and the knowledge we're getting from that, and we have technology that's just about to catch up with us to provide this brilliant insight on what we're actually thinking at the time. So the future looks bright for effective computing, including this kind of sensor, which is a brain computer interface. So going back to what I'm actually doing at the university, when I came in 2014, the project was, can you create a brain computer interface that uses other interactions, so multimodality, a multi-mode kind of system to help people rehabilitate and interact with computers better. So rehabilitation would be people who have been in an accident or maybe born with a disability, and now they want to communicate with a computer or interact with people in a better, more convenient way. Now, technology hasn't been fair to them because technology has been developed for the mass market. People who have disabilities or people who have been in accidents, the technology, if you go into that kind of aspect of using that, you'd find, oh, this is really actually annoying to use. Why would anybody actually use this if they had to? The truth is, they have to actually use it. There is no alternative. So what my research is doing is trying to find better ways of helping people rehabilitate and communicate with a computer. In the first year of my research, I tried to take a emotive epoch. I don't know if you've seen it. I'm going to try to just look one up right now so you guys see what it looks like. It was a kind of, I guess, first generation device, BCI, so emotive epoch. And it was, if you see the photos of it, you'll see what I mean. So that's what it looks like. And that's how it rests on the head. So there's this huge thing that goes behind your head, that bit. So if you're resting in a chair, as a lot of people who are rehabilitated need a wheelchair or they're in their bed, you can imagine how having that across your head would actually move the whole system in front of you and disconnect the front sensors. So that wasn't a great device for our research, but it gave us a starting point to collect data and see if the data could be classified by what, but what I mean by that is, can I collect brain EEG samples from the brain? EEG is just electric samples off the forehead, off the skull, and can I understand something from that? So after I took those EEG waves, I put them in a MATLAB program, used different signal processing methods, and I found a way that I could classify simple differences, so simple commands. The commands I was interested in, as you would suspect, is left or right, yes and no. So I wanted to keep it simple. Keeping it simple reduces complexity and it makes it more, makes the system more accurate. So if I want to, for example, classify 10 different things, for example, different types of vegetables using the BCI system, you'd have a high error rate. I might be thinking I want apples, but the system says that person was thinking about oranges, so that's not really great. Using the two-class classification, I managed to get around 60%. I did further tweaking with my system. I kind of specialized it to get rid of the EMG noise. EMG noise is very popular in EEG waves, is the muscle artifact. So when you move your neck, all these kind of muscles in here, you get spikes in the actual EEG wave that is coming from your forehead or when you blink, because those muscles are much stronger than the brain waves, the neurons in your brain that are actually going through your skull and then coming on the top of your forehead skin. So there's a huge difference between muscles what the muscle wave, the EMG wave looks like, and the EEG, and that gives us an opportunity to kind of filter that out. The EMG wave goes huge, it's like a huge spike that goes up, and then falls back down to what the EEG is, like that. And when you blink, you see this kind of thing. It drops down and then goes up. So if you think of, I don't know if you guys have any background in electronics, but if you ever held a battery, it has a plus side and a negative side. That just means it's providing a difference in potential. If you connect the plus and negative side, you've created a circuit, the electricity just goes round and round. It's the same on your forehead. When your brain is producing electricity, it's using your scalp as one of the poles, and it's inside, there's the other pole. So imagine if that's a circuit like that, it's going from your brain to your skin, and it's going back like that. Then suddenly, something like an eye blink disrupts that, and it creates a huge dip in it. So it's taking all that electricity, and it's either pushing away because of that huge muscle artifact, and it's moving that, and that's why you get a huge dip on the sensor, or when you're moving your neck, you get a huge pulse like that. And that is like pretty much one of the problems in EEG and making it commercially viable as a rehabilitation device is how are you going to actually manage all that movement while somebody has this accessory on their head and they're moving? So you're going to have to deal with a lot of noise, and that's one of the biggest challenges I've been facing in my research. I'm just going to try to log in to my email finally. So in the second year of research, I started looking into other forms of communication. One of the other forms of communication that we talked about was eye gaze. So what I did was I did a research study at a local school, the Oakfield School of, it's a kind of exercise, it's a kind of sports school for people with learning disability and cerebral palsy. So what the study we did was pretty much we took this EEG headband and we asked the students to look at sad and happy images. And we also had a state-of-the-art eye tracking device, and we asked them to complete sentences just using their eye gaze. And you'd be surprised how well they were able to complete these tasks. There was always the learning curve at the start, but we expected that. But after you gave them gave them a few examples of what needed to be accomplished, the students with cerebral palsy were able to use their eyes by literally looking at the screen and completing a 5-word sentence. And they did that continuously, repetitively, and they were able to use that interface to communicate. Now, the purpose of the study was to see how effective a eye gaze communication device can be for rehabilitation and communication for a cerebral palsy student, and if we could at the same time record the EEG brain waves and see if the same classification results I had for people without learning difficulty or people without cerebral palsy would be able to kind of expand that and say the users with cerebral palsy could also use this for simple classification. And if I wanted to explain why we wanted to do that, it was literally because if you've ever met anybody with cerebral palsy, and some of them have there's different ranges of disability, but the ones in the school, some of the people there have profound disability. That means that they cannot communicate using normal voice kind of talking to you. So they have their own signals. And the care workers there all have like little special books that they write. This person communicates like this. This person is excited when he or she does this. So you'd have, you'd open up the book and they would say, oh, he would make a low kind of sound like that when he wants something or when she's excited about something, or she would wave her arms like that when she is excited or she wants your attention, for example. So if you can kind of visualize that, that's not the most, most efficient way to communicate with somebody, is trying to kind of guesstimate your way towards what they want to say. So is there a better way? Is there a better way? So in my head, I imagine that kind of the answer to what anybody's thinking, this affective state could actually answer that. If we use the headset, which has a kind of unique, novel way of understanding what a person wants, I think that will provide us with huge insight into understanding their needs, what they want from us, to get their feedback on what we provided for them, and can kind of anticipate their affective state when we're teaching them something. So if we're teaching them something, can the EEG wave show us how excited they are? And can we alter our learning learning plan and kind of personalize that for them? So that's a kind of huge research point right now, is personalized learning, and how personalized learning can increase engagement and learning outcome and deep learning. So we found that I was able to kind of, and I kind of expected this, but I was able to classify the EEG waves of the people with cerebral palsy and learning difficulty with some accuracy, but less accuracy than I expected. So it was around 40 to 50%. For a two-class system, that's just random, but we had a three-class system. So we had three classes. It was happy, sad, and neutral. So the neutral state, which I've kind of added to this research, and it's kind of new to BCI interface classification, is a state that the person does not want to kind of engage with the system, or if the person is relaxed and is not trying to kind of initiate a BCI engagement. Why is that important? Because if you imagine, if you have this headset on your head all the time and you're using it as a communication method, if it's always saying yes and no, where is the middle ground? Where is the, I don't care right now, leave me alone, or I'm trying to have rest? When you're using a system, usually you interact with it by just picking it up and pressing something on it. But if the EEG headset is always going to be on your head and you don't have the kind of physical capability of turning it on or turning it off, that neutral state is actually quite a practical solution to classifying and that kind of communication that you would have with the BCI headset, if you can imagine that scenario. So what I did was, so I had around 40 to 50%. And the three-class classification, the random kind of classification, you would need to beat that kind of randomness, is 33%, because it's one out of third, so 33.33, we're repeating three. If you get anything above that, you have some reasonable information. So the next stage after that is to kind of say that, okay, BCI can give us some information, but it's not the be-all and end-all of affective state. So in my next experiment, which I'm going to start in January, and I've already had the ethics forms and participants sign up for it, it's going to be an experiment where we do continuous performance tests. A continuous performance test is just the classic psychological test is, you sit behind a computer, there's little things popping on the screen, it's an A, B, X test. So you're supposed to press the button whenever you see the X, and you only press the button whenever you see the X after the A. If you see the X after the B, you're supposed to, yeah. No, I'm not going to press it now. So there's also, so there's mistakes when you press it after you see it to B, or you press it as a foul. If you press it after that A, that's, you're supposed to do that, that's a good job. If you press it on A or B accidentally, you've been a little bit too, eager for it. So that kind of test has been around since the 1970s or 1960s. And what it does is it tries to measure how long somebody can be attentive, and if the reaction time slows down after time. There was another test, it was the Clockworth test. I think this one's actually quite crazy. Is the hand would move in seconds, but sometimes it would move a little bit longer than a second. Sometimes it would wait and then jump. Sometimes it would go faster. And they would have people who were training to be in World War II radar specialists look at that clock for hours and try to press the button on the second hand would skip or be faster or be slower. So if you can imagine, that's a very hard test to go down. They found out that people would lose their attention after 5 to 15 minutes. So there's no really, there wasn't much of a point having them sit behind an hour to find out that was it. So I'm just going to go through the slideshow that now I have on the screen. Brilliant. So some of the EEG waves that you see here, so there's some kind of information that you can get from an EEG wave. If you notice, your relaxed one has this kind of rhythm to it. It's like very slow, it goes up and down, and there's like a simple pattern to that. The reason for that relaxed pattern is the beauty behind the relaxed EEG pattern is that it stops you from stressing out. So your brain is a huge, like, huge kind of factory of neurons. There's so many neurons in there, you can't keep track of them. When they fire at all at the same time, they kind of overlap sometimes and they confuse each other. You get headaches, you get frustrated, you get irritated. Part of that is how the machine of your brain works, is there a lot of electricity in there, and there needs to be a calming wave over them that calms them down and kind of makes the kind of spasmic response of the neurons kind of less. And that's the relaxed kind of wave that kind of goes over all the waves and calms you down. A lot of interest in brain health has been invested in this EEG relaxed wave, and they're selling these EEG recording devices as ways to kind of meditate. When I usually have people wear this headset and I have this tablet with me, and we could try it out if you guys are interested afterwards, just to see, so you guys could see your brain waves afterwards. But the thing is that people see, oh, my brain waves are like, you know, you can't see them, they're like really soft. And you're like, no, that's a good thing, because if your brain was all over the place, going up and down, and then going back down, and then going up and down again, if it wasn't something consistent, that means you actually are having a stressful day. So you don't want that. You want something very calm and just same thing all the time, and you can practice to get there, to be honest. So I think that's my talk for today. Sorry if it was a bit rushed. I just always can't get on NTU Wi-Fi when I need it to. But I'm going to finish off with answering some questions. And if anybody wants to come over after the talk to try the headset on and just see, I mean, it'd be a fun experience. Not many people have seen this anyway, so let me know. Questions? Questions? How would I like it. So if anybody wants to come out, I'm just going to set this up.